on doing? All right, how's everyone doing? Holla, that's the energy we want in this space. So welcome to the People's Forum. How many of you have been here before? All right, just a few of you. And those of you who have been here before, welcome back. And those who haven't been here, welcome to your new home. Because you don't know it yet, but you're going to be back. Are we going to be back? Yeah, you just committed yourself. So before you leave, make sure I grab your digits. So my name is Claudia de la Cruz, and I am part of the team of folks that envisioned and created the space. We want to welcome you into our home, a movement incubator. Our desire is to be able to nourish and equip and walk with the folks that believe in liberation, freedom, those folks that are struggling, the working class people. And so we are here tonight in the spirit of decolonizing and resisting all systems of exploitation and oppression, and finding a way of bridging our struggles so that we could be stronger together. What do y'all think about that? So we have an amazing program tonight, and later on we're gonna have an amazing concert, and we're gonna have amazing music, and we're just gonna rock it out. And then hopefully when we leave here, we have enough energy to fight all the systems we need to fight together. And so I wanna introduce our moderator for tonight. We're gonna have a conversation on resisting and decolonizing through culture. People internationally. She is one of the founders of Existence is Resistance, and her name is Nancy Mansour.
Thank you. I feel so special. My name is Nancy Mansour. I am one of the founders of Existence is Resistance. If you've heard of us, can I just see a show of hands? Okay.
We're doing all right.
A little bit. I just want to make one point real quick. My brother Musab, put your hand up in the back there. Musab right there is a Palestinian from 67, which is the West Bank. Walat, put your hand up. This is a Palestinian sister from Gaza, the part they call Gaza. And then I'm from 48, which is what they refer to as Israel, but we don't because they stole it in 1948. And so we refer to it as 1948. But I just wanted to make the point that the three of us are here together today, and in our own country, we can't meet unless we're in jail, in an Israeli jail. That's the only way we'd be able to meet. So it's really special every time, and it's something that always hits me. Like every time I'm in a room with Palestinians, I'm always like trying to scope out what areas we're from and whether we'd be able to meet in our own country, and we can't, but we will soon. Before we get started with the panel, there are some really, really amazing people that are gonna be up here tonight. I'm freestyling because I'm always late with shit. But you know, that's just how I am. I just go with the wind. So before I do that, I have an amazing video that I want to show you, and I feel that it's really fitting for tonight, just to kind of set the mode. It's by a brother. It's an older video. It's called Indigenous Holocaust, and it's from a native brother called Wawate Benais. So we're going to play that video real quick, and I'll be right back.
Took his son from his home, yeah, they pulled him apart. They took a daughter from her home, they were forced to depart. Amongst the others on the train, they called the Iron Horse. Another native fell victim to the Holocaust. The devils came to the village, popes and his priests, stealing children from their homes. Took and placed them in a school to erase them and undo what they labeled as savage. Before the gates of long hair, she had tossed in a pile like it was garbage stripped down from your customer type. Your skin scrubbed till it bleed, put his clothes in the fight, and bury his items, replace them with ours. Give him a Bible, teach him the
read, preach him indeed. If he speaks one word of his tongue, no song sung from the homeland, which he learned as a young buck. From an old sage in the village to a schoolmate of break, where they plan was to kill him. Save the man was the model, sodomized by a priest. Traumatized, getting beat, cooling races when he eat. Many die cause they starve, no one notified. Buried in the yard for not following the cross. All the vessels for my ancestors, your heart beats through me.
They took his son from his home, yeah, they pulled him apart. They took a daughter from her home, they were forced to depart. Amongst the others on the train, they called the Iron Horse. Another native fell victim to that Holocaust.
Good, forget, I'm not sure I could. They say time heals everything, but I'm still waiting.
She came from a family of five. She was 9 at the time when they came to pay the people a visit. With a man who translated the language, they promised beautiful things that she attended without mentioning the evil they imposed. His hands clammy and they go as he shakes with a smile on his face. Now she on her way to Carlisle with no knowledge of her fate. He tell her, calm down, calm down. We at the gate, she see the faces of her schoolmates saddening both. They sat her down, cut her hair and made her wear proper clothes to look civilized. No one living like a tribe lies. So if you try to speak a word of your tongue, your mouthwash was the punishment amongst others. Girls raped and made mothers, babies born, babies murdered. Women sterilized, an act of genocide. You heard me, the government, cause we didn't die, we survived.
They took his son from his home, yeah, they pulled him apart. They took a daughter from her home, they were forced to depart. Amongst the others on the train, they called the Iron Horse. Another native fell victim to that Holocaust.
Sounds good, forget, I'm not sure I could. They say time heals everything, but I'm still waiting.
For more than 500 years we've been fighting to live. 80s baby born in 85, 12 years after Wounded Knee. But what about the massacre when they slaughtered 309? Talking about the movie 1890 on a cold December day when the cavalry came and started shooting cause of ceremony. Scared we might raise the dead and take back our lands. Raise our arms and make a stand and fighting back with these words. If you don't know your past, then your future is bleak. So seek knowledge from the elders who still live and hold the teachings for the people. We the moral, gotta carry on traditions for our children, so we bridging the gap. Cause press out to break us down by creation of school. 1879, we were taking treated cruel like some animals. The priest never took sabbatical from beating and raping your women and men. Demons.
They took his son from his home, yeah, they pulled him apart. They took a daughter from her home, they were forced to depart. Amongst the others on the train, they called the Iron Horse. Another native fell victim to that Holocaust.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
First Nations united.
I'm not sure I could. They say time heals everything, but I'm still waiting.
Thank you, thank you. All right, we're going to get started. It's all late because of me. I'm taking the full blame for this, and I don't mind at all. We love you too. I'm always late for everything, so if you ever see my name on a flyer, come an hour later. Just let you know. And it's not on purpose, just shit happens. I don't know why, it just happens to me. But I want to introduce we have a really beautiful panel, and I'm really, really excited. First up, because the brother I'm about to introduce, I actually met in Palestine, and this is the first time I see him out here. So make some noise for hip-hop artist and music producer Frank Waln. This is exciting. We met at a house party in Ramallah, and Vic Mensa was DJing. They were on the Dream Defenders tour. We had the Existence Resistance tour, and it just came together, and it was beautiful. Next up, I want you to make some noise and give a beautiful welcome to spoken word artist, author, and founder of Dream Warriors, our sister Tanaya Winder. And last but not least, a beautiful sister who traveled with us to Palestine in 2016 and was part of our crazy tour. Make some noise for Mahina Movement's Mauna. You can see I'm reading the email as we go along, because... Okay, I'm going to let you all introduce yourselves, and then I'll come back to me. So just tell me where you're from and how you got involved and what you do.
Mitako yapi. Oyate tacha omani and machapelo. Naha iyuha chante washte and ape chuzapelo. Hello, relatives. I just introduced myself in my language. I said my Lakota name is Oyate tacha omani, which means walks with the young nation or walks with the new nation. That name was given to me in ceremony by elders from my home community. I come from a community on the Rosebud Reservation called the Hedog Community. I was born and raised there, and I'm a Sicangu Lakota hip-hop artist, writer, music producer, audio engineer, and I think what I do, I just call it storytelling, whatever the form is, because it comes from the same source and the same voice, so I just say I'm a storyteller.
Mike, Nunania Tanaya Winder, Nunania Tumutwa Chichmamach. My name's Tanaya Winder. I just introduced myself in Southern Ute. My Indian name is a winter bird woman. It means during the winter time when all the other birds leave that the winter bird stays to continue bringing song to and music to the people. So that's what I would say that I do, is I bring song just to my people and my community, whether it's in ceremony, whether it's just to make my kids laugh or my family laugh, and to also just act as a form of prayer and healing just in spoken word and poetry. And you'll be hearing more of that later tonight. I just started playing the guitar, so it took, and maybe that will come out more in the panel, but it just took me a really long time to be able to believe in my gifts in that way and to embody more of that storytelling.
Malolele, marhaba, ko hoko hingo a ko vai moana li ti a makikau whakinu me tolu na afele i au nuko lofa tonga. My name is Vai Moana Litia Makakau Fakinu Me Tolu. You can call me Moana. That is not just a name of a Disney film. That is actually a place we call home. Moana means ocean. And for many of us, we do not have borders before we were colonized by these colonized names such as Polynesia or Micronesia or all those other fucked up names. So our name is Moana, Oceania. That is where I'm from. That is where I was born. I was raised, I was born in Kolomotu'a, the village of Kolomotu'a. And I say that, and I'm so excited to be here with these amazing people, and that to say that we are on indigenous land. This has always been indigenous land, and it always will be. So that red carpet is called the indigenous red carpet. So all the indigenous peeps, everyone, please take your time when you walk on that and just how we walk on this land. So I love to say, even though, you know, it's like, what is she saying? I love to say where I was born and where I am from, and that the village that I was born in is the same village that both of my parents and 20 ancestors back of the names that my father taught me. I come from that village, and that we still exist. I am so happy to be here with Nancy, Frank, and Tanaya. Thank you so much, and thanks for coming.
I'm Nancy Mansour. Nancy, because my dad liked Frank Sinatra. I was called Baby Mansour for 3 months, and then Frank Sinatra came on the TV talking about his daughter. He had the song Nancy with the laughing face or whatever, and apparently I always laugh, even in serious shit. So my dad called me Nancy. I was born and raised in London to Palestinian parents that didn't speak English, so I didn't speak English till I was 5. And I'm Palestinian 100% through and through. My father was born in 1939 before the Zionists came and renamed it Israel. And have been and continue to oppress Palestinians and murder Palestinians on a daily basis. The organization Existence is Resistance, we founded in beginning of 2009, really because I've done like hip-hop radio. My sister, if anybody knows, Shadia Mansour, is a Palestinian hip-hop artist who I also manage. And so just through the music, I wanted to do something for Gaza when it was being bombarded in 2008, 2009. And I actually did an event called Hands Off Gaza, and I invited everybody that I knew in the music industry. So like M1 came through, Rebel Diaz came through, Johnny Juice of Public Enemy. There was a bunch of people, and the love that we felt in that room that night showed us like the power of music and art as resistance. And how you don't even need to understand the words, but you could feel it. You know what I'm saying? There's just, you know how you say some people just got it? Like you either got it or you don't got it? You know what I'm saying? It was that, it's like you either feel it or you don't feel it. And if you're a human with real compassion and you love life and you love human beings, then you got it. You know what I'm saying? So from that, we formed Existence Resistance and we started doing tours. I had done a couple of other tours with other people prior to that from 2007. But 2009, we went to Gaza and we took M1 of their prayers. Loki from the UK and Marzi, a brother, Iranian brother from New York, and we went to Gaza after it got bombed July 4th of 2009. Since then, I've done tours in the West Bank just because it's a lot easier. I mean, it's really, really hard to get in and out of Gaza, and it took us 8 days to get in, and they only gave us 24 hours and blah, blah, blah. It's a whole other story. But we've done tours ever since. There are a couple of years, like 2014, when Gaza got bombarded again for the 100th time. I just felt it was too dangerous to bring people, so we took the money we raised and we went to the hospitals of all the kids and people they were bringing from Gaza into the West Bank, and we were just buying them what they needed, cell phones and stuff. Our current project is called Black in the Holy Land. It's a documentary about all the black communities in Palestine, and that includes 48, what they call Israel. It includes the Sudanese and Eritrean refugees that are in the south, dumped in the desert, in an open-air prison. We're including all the black communities we came across. And it's actually, since December, it's been backed now by Mark Lamont Hill and Stacey Mohammed's production company, 305 Productions. So I'm really, really excited. And that movie should be out by spring of next year. So please keep your eyes open. It's a really, really deep documentary about black folk in Palestine. Because, you know. All right, I'm gonna get you started. That was, see, I'm not bad at this. All right, so the first thing I wanted to know is what got you involved in the movement as such? Like, what did you go right from your art? Did you go right into the movement with your art, or was it something that was a shift? And also for those of you that are involved in the Palestine work, how did your work become? You know, how did you make that connection and get connected with Palestine?
Well, for me, it was kind of a natural progression. I started playing music at age 7. And I grew up disconnected from my culture until I was in my teens because it was illegal for us to practice our ceremonies until 1978. So when I was growing up, there was a lot of shame around being indigenous because it was beat into the people that were raising us, from our great-grandparents to our grandparents to our parents. And so music was a safe space for me. It was an act of survival. I was a really introverted kid. You know, I dealt with a lot of depression and anxiety growing up in you know, the place I grew up in. So music was like a safe space for me. So I started writing songs and playing music to heal. And I kept it a secret for a while. And you know, I left home. I was fortunate enough to get the Gates Millennium Scholarship when I graduated high school, and I was able to leave my reservations located in South Central South Dakota, and I was able to go to school, and I was, you know, been playing music since I was a kid, and it was around when I left home and I started realizing the huge gap of ignorance that exists in this country about, you know, indigenous people and our history. I got my Bachelor of Arts from a place called Columbia College in Chicago, and the first week I was there, I met a college-educated adult that thought indigenous people were extinct, you know, and I was just like, this is, I started realizing how complete their genocide was, that, like, people are living on our land, and they think we're extinct, and I grew up on a reservation, a remnants of a concentration camp, and I didn't even know that until I was in my 20s, you know, because they didn't teach us these things in school, not until I started reading from indigenous writers. So as I started learning about, you know, the history of even my own people, I started to get really angry and frustrated, and so I was just putting it into my art and putting it into my music, and I found I was just, again, writing those songs to heal, and then I was putting them out, and other young Native people who felt the same way started just saying, you know, you articulated what I felt in that song so well, like, I feel seen by your music. And I never thought about that. You know, I just wanted to tell my story through my music, and it was an act of survival. And I think a lot of younger Native artists I know, that was kind of our story. Our art was our survival. And then, you know, as we grow up and we want to help our people, we want to contribute to our community because we're indigenous, we use our gifts to do that, and just constantly trying to find new ways to use our gifts to express our love for our people and rebuild our nations. And to the last part of the question, how it connected to Palestine for me was through the Dream Defenders. Two summers ago, they asked me to go on an artist delegation to Palestine, and it was a group of black and brown artists, mainly black artists, and I was an indigenous artist they brought. But it changed my life forever, that trip. You know, I met you out there. It was really, I didn't know I was going to see you until you walked in the room. But that trip changed my life forever, and I can't not tell people about Palestine now after the things that I've seen. Especially I've seen how it related to early reservation system days. Like, our reservations were open air prison systems too, you know. And so just seeing the parallels almost in government policy and how they are making these people's lives a living hell to take their land. You know, I knew what that felt like. And so I tell people, I looked in the eyes of Palestine and I saw my reflection, and I didn't expect that. And it just like shook me up as an indigenous person. So it changed my life. And it's going to come out. I've been able to meet a lot of really great Palestinian musicians, and we're gonna work on music to talk about the similarities in our struggles. And I think our art is a great place to meet in the middle and kind of see the similarities in our stories, our communities, our struggles, and kind of work that out through the art.
So for me, I guess I just really struggled with just thinking about what the movement even meant growing up. So for me, I was really lucky to have grown up on a reservation, and that to have had a mother who had always participated in ceremony, a father who was a sun dancer, and my mom would always go to sweat. And so I would just grow up singing songs, and songs were for us a form of prayer. Like, it would help us through our suffering, it would help us find healing, it would help us just heal each other and like connect to each other and like lift our prayers up in that way. And so song was always sacred for me in that way, but I never really thought about like how song lived in me and through me. And I think a lot of that comes from just my grandmother being taken away from her reservation and being put into the boarding school system, because my grandma loves to sing, and just, you know, the horrible things that happen to people in boarding school. She didn't teach us her language. She doesn't even really talk about the things that happened there. She just always shares with me this one story about how she won this talent contest singing Blue Moon. And she gets so happy every time she like tells that story, and she would always just be like, I won and I can sing and things like that. And so I always knew that song just lived in me in that way. But I didn't really connect the two for such a long time, just because I think, you know, just the whole things of like capitalism and the things that they wanted us to think that were successful on a reservation was to like live like a life that was like white, you know, like get rich, have a big house, live in like a suburb type place. Like, I would watch all these TV shows like Dawson's Creek and like shit like that growing up, and thinking like that's what like high school is going to be like. Like, that's what life's going to be like, this like picket fence and stuff like that, you know. Like, I didn't know it was going to be like, you know, trying to like find a place where we didn't have to live with my father who was abusive, like trying to find an apartment on a reservation that didn't cater to like non-tribal members, like stuff like that. And so I was just focused on like wanting to be successful. So I went to Stanford, I was trying to become a lawyer, but like just didn't realize like all of the traumas that like happened to me and my family personally, not really like being able to cognitively be aware that that was all related to like colonial trauma and things that were passed down. And so I just felt this impulse, like this seed, this need to write poetry, to just remember, to like process, to like heal. And so I started writing poetry, but still, like, I feel like I just was that seed struggling for such a long time to like break through, because at Stanford they taught us like white poetry. Like, I learned more about Shakespeare and Wallace Stevens than like the poetry of my people or the songs of my people. And so I was really caught in that like matrix machine for a while, just like wanting to be successful in that way. And so I just wrote that kind of poetry for a long time. And it wasn't until one of my best friends committed suicide on campus that I wrote for me, and I wrote to heal. And I saw how it was all connected, and that how his trauma was connected to what happened to his parents when it happened to his grandparents, and how that all was like a product of history. And it just like blew my mind. And like, even that, like just still being afraid, you know, still being afraid to try, but then start doing more like spoken word, and it just feeling more natural, like just that our bodies are meant to breathe, our bodies are meant to sing, our bodies are meant to move, and that it could move through you, like that healing. But at the same time, like activism and like surviving just seem like this big crazy river, and it's like just so much is going on. It's like, should I jump in now? Oh no, yeah, oh wait, right here. Oh no, there's like a big thing, you know. And just finally, only like I guess maybe since 2015 when I met Frank did I finally feel like I met people who would like reach their hand out and help pull me into like where I needed to be. And so now I feel like I'm just starting to explore more poetry and more music and what that means to me, to honor my grandmother and her path and to try to relearn my language and to try to teach it to myself by writing it in poetry and writing it in songs and reclaiming it in that way. And I was one of those people, I was just so ignorant too about like Palestine. It wasn't until Frank went, and he is like such a powerful storyteller, like he does like walk his talk and talk about it every time like we perform, and I would just learn more about it through him, and I was just like, wow, like I just can't believe like just how plugged into the matrix, even trying to be a woke person, like just how you can't see those things, like you have to go out and like actually seek the truth.
Well, since earlier I told you I was born in Tonga, and then as soon as I was born, my family moved to Hawaii, which is occupied land as well, and it is indigenous land. So like most South Pacific Islanders, when we come to the United States, we stop in Hawaii. So I was raised in La'ia, Hawaii, and then we moved to Ute, Shoshone, and Dene land, Utah, because my parents converted to the Mormon church, which is also another colonial system. So, you know, the moment I came to this country at 4 years old, Nancy, just like when you ask about, you know, what do you, you know, when did you think about the movement? I felt like as a four-year-old, I still, you know, we just came from a tropical place, right? So it was the worst winter in Utah, so it was a blizzard when my family landed in the Salt Lake City airport, and I remember looking down at my flip-flops, right, and looking at my dad's wearing like his favorite Aloha shirt, and then I just remember looking at all these white people, and I've never, you know, we have never seen snow, we've never seen white people, and I'm like, we're so used to like, as indigenous people, we are so used to hospitality, especially in Palestine. Oh my God, we'll talk about Palestine after, but so used to just like welcoming, right? Like, hey, welcome new land, you're not from here. And I just remember just like all the white people just straight up just like, what the hell are you here? You know? So when we looked at our cards that said, I don't know if they still put it, it says alien, it says residential alien, right? And so I just remember like, welcome to America, we are aliens. We don't belong here with this type of skin, with this type of body, right? Everything was just like a no, and I knew that. So I was raised in Provo, which is the most conservative, like Orrin Hatch. Y'all were listening to Orrin Hatch, right? Past week, straight up Utah, where it's predominantly white, Mormon, heterosexual, homophobic Mormon country. And how the Mormons got there, they killed all the indigenous people, pushed them to reservations, right? We're like, you stay in your little prison while we uplift God, right? Jesus Christ. So that's what I was raised in. And so just like both of you, maybe most of us in this room, it was like, the American dream, come to this country, you better speak English like an American, go to school. So that's how I ended up in NYU, Columbia, Yale. That is the American dream. That's what makes you like, you know, white is the best thing, right? And you speak English. And it's just like, no, fuck that, you know? I'm Tongan, I'm an indigenous person. I wanna learn what I wanna learn. And also just not fuck that, it's like, our practices are so beautiful, and they're so amazing. And so that's why Mahina Movement is called Mahina Movement. Mahina comes from the Tongan word moon, and it's also from the Spanish word imagina, which means imagine. And just shout out to you, Nancy, and Existence is Resistance, because you're the first person who took me to Palestine. Philistine Fikalbi. My life is not the same since you took me there in 2016. Nancy, thank you for believing in Mahina Movement, for bringing us there, and you kept on insisting. I even was like, girl, I don't even have money right now to go Palestine. And you're like, Juana, come on, I'll front you, like, come on. And you did that
actually for the past 11 years. Even before 2 years ago, you're like, come on, can you guys come to Palestine with y'all, us? And going to Palestine for me was just a life-changing, inspiring, awesome, beloved moment for me in my life, and it has changed me. I actually moved out to Palestine last year, and then the fifth time, so imagine that, Nancy. So you went the first time I went with you, and then the fifth time, that's when I was denied entry. So so first and foremost, I just want to say Palestine is beautiful. And why it changed my life is because you see kids every day resist. Like, not just adults, right, or elders. You see 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds, 7-year-olds, brothers and sisters take rocks, whatever their words, anything, and they will just, like, have your back, have their back, have everyone else's back, and say, and they'll be the first to say, this is our land, welcome to Palestine. And so you just have so much love. So just shout out to Palestine. Love Palestine so much.
Yeah. Hashtag emotional, son. Yeah, Palestine is beautiful. It's crazy because, you know, the one thing that I really do thank Israel for is basically raising, like, Palestinian children have no fear whatsoever. Like, whatsoever. Like, at this point, anything can happen. I mean, a lot more than just, when I say 3 massacres, but my sister sitting right here from Gaza, when you watched all that shit on TV, if whatever channels would show it, where they were blowing, you know, entire families and areas into smithereens and, like, kids' body parts flying around. I mean, she was in that and made it out. You know, and it's like, people don't realize, first of all, 65% of the, over 65% of the population is under, what, 25 in Gaza? And if you think about the trauma that they've, that Israel's created there, like the trauma, that doesn't go away, I don't think, ever. You know what I'm saying? But the one thing that I learned, especially going back, because again, I had a privileged life, I could always leave, you know what I'm saying? I have a passport so I can go into 48 and come out and whatever. But the one thing I always learned was a no fear factor. So, you know, when I'm there, I'm on the ground. Like, I'm not just going to be talking all this shit, and then when I'm there, I'm running. I mean, I don't go right in front of the soldier. Well, I do actually sometimes. But my thing is, they all have guns. I have a gun. I didn't grow up, like, you know, for a 5-year-old, I just remember, I'm going to tell you this one story. We were going to this demonstration. It was called the 48,000-person demonstration in 2014. And it was like, when I tell you, like, it was just people. Like, you couldn't see nothing but people in the streets. And I remember walking down towards it. There was ambulances coming and going. They couldn't even get through the crowd. I think like almost 304 people got shot in total that day. And about 7 of my friends with like butterfly bullets. I don't know if you know, they got wings and they split in your leg and they come in one side, break, you know, like smash all the bone and come out the other. And I had like friends with like fountains of shit. But anyway, we were walking down to the main checkpoint. And I remember this old man with like a grandfather with his grandkid. And the kid was like maybe, I know, 4 years old, no older than 4, and he was rolling this tire down. So, you know, as Palestinians, to deter the Israeli soldiers so they can't see you, light up tires, you know, for the thick black smoke so you can throw rocks. And as this kid's, like, pushing the tire down towards the checkpoint, these ladies that were walking next to me said to the old man, are you going to let him go in front of the soldiers and light up a tire? And he turned around and he said, why, is he any better than any child that's died here? You know, and that, I don't know, it's just, Palestine is somewhere that gives you strength. Like, every time I go, I always think, like, oh, you know, we're bringing something or whatever. But at the end of every tour, when we do our report backs, hearing everybody speak, they always feel like they came back with something more than what we gave those kids. You know what I'm saying? Because these kids have absolutely nothing to lose. Like, we still flinch at certain shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, I mean, gunshots maybe not as much because we're so used to them out there. But, you know, like, we still flinch at certain things out here. And out there, it's nothing. Like, it could be a machine gun and kids would just keep walking like it's nothing. And it's not normal, but, you know, it's a good trait to have, I guess.
So I wanted to ask, you know, we founded our organization because of the power that we felt in that room on that one night in 2009. And obviously ongoing with all the artists that we've taken and everything that they've brought back. M1 A Dead Prez did his own tour called From the Ghetto to Gaza and went all over California talking about his trip. So, you know, there's been a lot of powerful moves made from these trips. But I wanted to ask you, as far as your art and your people, how do you see your role being, like, how do you feel, or how do you see it being productive in crushing colonialism and oppression?
That's a really great question. We don't get to talk about these things too much, but we talk about them together because we're figuring it out. But you know, I think my role as a man, as a hetero man, as a cis man, is to you know, one of the things I really try to do with like Tanaya and other sisters to perform with is leverage my privileges to create space for my relatives who aren't traditionally let into those spaces. And so, like, you know, in that, right, I'll tell you guys a story. It was me and Tanaya. Were you at the Standing Rock gig? Mm-mm. Oh, so I was doing a performance at Standing Rock a couple years ago, and the concert was just kind of really unorganized, and there was just a lot of, like, really patriarchal stuff happening, and there was a lot of Native women artists that were kind of being left out, and it was just really messed up. And this Native woman, her name is Ridmilla Cody, she's Danaean Black. She came up to me and she looked me in the eyes and she was like, there's a lot of cis hetero patriarchal shit going down right now. And I was like, I'm ready to bail. Like, I don't even want to take up space because, like, you guys need to perform. And they were trying to make me go up. And she was like, no, she's like, you need to provide balance. You need to use these opportunities that you get and bring balance. Like, because I was going to do a song about my mom. She's like, go up and do the song about your mom. Like, bring some balance. And so, you know, after that, I kind of realized my position as an indigenous artist transversing spaces at home, spaces outside of home, is to bring some sort of balance, whether that be education, whether that be leveraging my privileges to provide opportunities, whether that be connecting people to indigenous communities through my art and my stories, and using my art and my gift of storytelling so other people can see themselves in our stories and relate. And those become pathways of empathy, because you may never know what it's like to be on the Rosebud Rez, but after you see me do my thing with my music, you're gonna feel what that feels like a little bit. And so I think, you know, one of my goals as an indigenous artist is to provide balance in whatever ways I can. And also use our art and our, and you know, just our careers to reclaim our indigeneity and be like, no, it's not shameful, you know, because it used to be shameful to have long hair where I was growing up, men to wear earrings, you know, because the colonizers beat into us that was something shameful. So just reclaiming that as an artist and using my art and my music and my performance to just, you know, try to push back against the years of shame and blame that have been beat into our people. And so, you know, just continually using my gift. And also, much like Tanaya, you're gonna hear me do songs tonight. I'm writing songs in my language now. I didn't grow up fluent. Much like Tanaya, my great-grandmother went to boarding school and took Lakota to the grave with her. So, you know, just figuring out ways, like I said, to use our gifts to express our love for our people and rebuild our nations.
Yeah. So for me, my main, like, job is I run an Upward Bound program for Native American students from different reservations. And so I've been there since 2007, and in that time, it's just I learned more and more about, like, our youth and the things that we're going through and that they're going through, and just this country, as we all know, is just so sick. You know, like, just for all college students in general, suicide is the second leading cause of death, and for Native youth, it is very high as well. And so in my time, like, doing this work in the past decade, like, I've seen so much more cutting, so much more suicidal ideation, so much more attempts, and it's so sad to just help them understand and figure out where that comes from, and that it's not their fault. And it's almost like just slowly, like, trying to live by example through my art and peeling off those little layers of, like, that you are worthy. Because I think I know I still struggle with those things too, like my worth, like if I belong, like, what am I doing? And so it's just right now, it's just using that art to kind of lead by example and, like, Frank and I always joke that like we're constantly like healing in front of people like when we're doing this and performing, and to just show people like that it is an active like continuous process. Like nobody gets up on stage like totally healed and like passing on messages, but it's just like, you know, it comes through you, like it's going through you. That healing is always happening. And so for me, it's just trying to be brave to not like have to live that like capitalist, individualist life, and just try to continue to give back in as many ways as I can. And so for us, like, it's really hard because being in this country, it's so individualistic, like how many likes, how many retweets, how many follows, and it's hard to not like fall into that, but how to like remain grounded and what like grounds you, like your community, your language, prayer, ceremony, and all those are connected to like music. And so what we all do, I think, is a sacred practice, and I think it's helping to get people to see that. And so for us, we're part of an artist collective called Dream Warriors, and so we've only recently started performing together. Like usually I perform a lot with Frank, but it's mostly everyone on their own, and it's finally us trying to all perform together. And it's so amazing. Like we just got back from a Heal It tour in Oklahoma, visiting different schools and boarding schools and residential schools, and for them to see all of us up there together, all five of us uplifting each other, shouting each other out, backing each other up on tracks and things, like a lot of them had just never seen anything like that. It's usually just one artist coming in, but like to have an indigenous group where like we do know each other and you can tell we're family, and do that like with such like intentionality, like that for us is what we're still learning to do, like still figuring out how to build that. And it's interesting. It's an interesting battle. It's an interesting struggle because people still would rather see like a photo of Frank than instead of like a photo of him like promoting like a brown woman or indigenous woman. Like it's a weird like mental game. But I know just us continuing to get out there and just show like you can be like a part of something and it doesn't have to be just you. Like that's at least where I'm trying to focus my art right now, is trying to balance how to be more of a collective instead of just be like an individual artist.
That's a great segue to introduce the two other women in Mahina Movement. I know I'm just the one representing Mahina Movement, but Lorena and Gabby are out there too, and we'll be performing together. And it's just so amazing to sing songs and share our prayers, our poems, our writings with y'all as women of color, right? As indigenous women. So most of our songs actually come out of us just hanging out. Gabby is always singing. She freestyles everything. And she does that in like closed spots. She won't ever do that in public, but she can freestyle like, no kidding, just give her a word and she'll just be like, for days, just like, yeah. And it really, so what we perform, we didn't really set out to be like, yeah, we're gonna perform. We just have so many things to say that our colonial, misogynistic, patriarchal system does not wanna hear, right? They don't want to see Palestinians living amazing lives, just being joyful, right? No, let's put them as like terrorists, you know? They don't want to put just beautiful indigenous women just dancing, you know? What do we have to see ourselves? Actually, nothing. We just don't see ourselves at all. Or we just see like another statistic, another rape, another murder. And we see the response to that is like, well, life goes on. So just live, you know? And so I just wanna shout out my indigenous family, people here of Turtle Islands. Like, you know, I don't think I would exist here being as proud as I am if I didn't see y'all like be proud of who you are. And say like, hey, we still lived in this fucked up system, but we're gonna sing our songs, we're gonna speak our language. So it wasn't until I wrote my first poem and put Tongan into that and I performed it in public with a lot of white people in there too. My dad's sitting in the back and he's like, man, all these people that don't even speak Tongan, they wanna hear what you're saying. And I was like, yeah, dad. You know, and you know, but he came from, you know, he grew up in Australia where the Aboriginals were killed, right? And pushed to And so he was like knocked up the head, like intellectually, emotionally, like, don't speak your native language. You speak English like a colonizer. And that's how you're gonna live your life. So shout out to all of us that still exist in this world where, you know, I didn't really know my history. That's my point as an artist, is I want to share this unknown, right, these secrets, this history from our point of view. And so it wasn't until I was older and that I became an artist that, you know, the Marshallese Islands that are located in Oceania, 65 nuclear bombs were tested on the Marshall Islands. And it was chosen because it was in so much ocean. That's what the United States, right, that's in the governmental papers. It was chosen because there's just so much ocean that no one would actually hear it or see it. And there's only a few people that we have to displace. So that was just, a few thousand. So that's not like millions, right? So that's why we can test these bombs. And so this French designer, so just a little piece of history, this French designer went to, he invented the bikini. The bikini is a Marshallese indigenous language, and it means coconut land. B means land, like surface, and ni means coconut. So that's why it's called bikini. So the fashion designer, the French fashion designer, invented the bikini, as we know, right? When we think of bikini, it's just like, because just 4 days after, when he invented it, he named it bikini or the atomic, because 4 days before that, they just put the biggest hydrogen bomb on the Bikini Island, in the Marshallese Islands, right? So they don't ever want to, when you hear of Hawaii, when you hear of the South Pacific, it's just like, wow, paradise. Just, everyone's just chilling, these savages, just barefoot. No, there are military or naval bases on all our islands. They don't want to say that, you know? Out of the whole entire world, 8 out of 10 countries that have the highest case in diabetes is in the South Pacific, because that's how we eat Spam, Vienna sausages, right? Like, wow, you're just like such big people playing football, whatever. No, like, you fucked up all our lands. And this is, and you know, so as an artist, I'm here not only to bring the joy and the love of indigenous people around the world, from Turtle Island to Palestine to Fiji to West Papua to Tonga, but I'm also here to remind these diabolical motherfuckers, we will never forget.
We should hashtag that, everybody, right now. Hashtag the People's Forum. Hashtag we will never forget. Hashtag still motherfucking here. So my next two questions are really, you know, I'll just be shaping shit how I want to shape it, because I think there are really important things that we don't always talk about that we need to, right? My next thing is making this documentary, Black in the Holy Land, has just taught me so much too, because I didn't know that Black Palestinians existed until 2011 when I started making this film. And there's different Black Palestinians. There's actually an event here. What date is it, Claudia? Me and Mark Lamont Hill will be actually doing it. 23rd, me and Mark Lamont Hill will be doing a presentation on Black in the Holy Land, just telling you about all the different communities, how they got there, kind of in preparation for the film that's coming. But doing that anyway, and then also, I love Ahmed Abu Znaid, one of the founders of the Dream Defenders, who took Frank on the trip to Palestine, is one of the realest motherfuckers that I know. And I say that because when we started Existence as Resistance, it wasn't just Palestine. It was Troy Davis. It was Trayvon Martin. It was a lot of things that we were asking other Palestinian and Arab organizations to come out to, and they didn't want to until it became cool. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, to me, when I speak, I'm always kind of like, it's not, it's, we are on the same side, right? There's the oppressed and then the oppressor. But you have to be able to understand different people's struggles, and you have to know your place in a struggle. You know what I'm saying? If you're not black, you don't know what the fuck it is to be black. If you're not Palestinian, you don't know what the fuck it is to be Palestinian. You could feel it, you know what I'm saying? But there's a lot of hijackers, too, in the movement. People always want to tell us at demonstrations, like, you can't say that. I don't give a fuck what you want me to say. As long as you're paying and bombing and murdering our fucking people, I'm going to do whatever the fuck. You don't get to choose what kind of resistance you get to your bullshit. You know what I'm saying? When you punch someone in the face, expect everything, bitch. Like, that's how we come in. So my question to you is, what is other people's roles? You know what I'm saying? Like, are there boundaries that people push? You know what I'm saying? Where they think they could come in and stuff. It's like Israelis. Like, it's great if you don't support if you were born there and you don't support the state of Israel and the occupation. But one thing that really bugged me out once was in one of the villages, they were having these weekly demonstrations, and I took one of my tours there. And I stopped taking them there because when we got there, in the community center, it was an Israeli ex-soldier that was giving the prep on, like, what to do if the... We know what to do if they start shooting, you know what I'm saying? Like, but it's like, it's like, you want to knock down my house and then come rebuild it. Like, nah, stay the fuck away. You can give me the materials, but you know what I'm saying? So they, you know, there's a lot of people that don't know their boundaries, you know what I mean? And a lot of people making money from our different causes, you know what I'm saying? There's a Palestine industry. You know what I'm saying? People make money from this shit. There's, you know, and so I just want you to talk a little bit about that, if you've seen that, and then, you know, how you feel people should step the fuck back, or, you know what I mean, what you would like to see happen.
Well, the first thing that comes to my head just as a native person is, like, you know, there's so much lack of education about who we are that, like, being a fraud in Indian country has been pretty easy. Like, there's people with academic careers, like, there are people who, like, are celebrated as indigenous scholars who aren't rooted in community just because, like, people don't know about our communities. And so, like, that's one of the first things that comes to my head, is that it happens, and I've seen it happen. But I'm going to have to start at, like, ground zero. And every, like, most times when I meet a person and they find out I'm indigenous, one of the things where boundaries always cross is people then tell you what they know about you. And most of the time, like, if you didn't hear it from a native person, it probably came from the imagination of a white man. And, like, you know, and it was hard to hear from indigenous people for hundreds of years. Indigenous erasure is deliberate, and it is very, it's, I say indigenous erasure is as American as apple pie. If you're an American, you're socialized into the cognitive dissonance of erasing indigenous people on all forms from the ground up. Like, people don't even think about us, you know? So I think for me, it's just like ground zero, just like, Just listen to us. Like, I meet so many people, and they're like, oh, I met this native one time. I met this Lakota person. I'm like, well, I met a white person. Do you know them? Like, just because you knew a Lakota doesn't mean I know them, you know? And so I think, you know, the boundaries that cost a lot when people just, like, you know, I think people just need to realize, especially in this country, we're built on a settler colony built on indigenous erasure, and that's, like, the starting point for most Americans. So just, like, listen to us. Just listen. Stop talking to us. Stop telling us what you think you know about us. Just listen to us. We're trying to speak. People say we've been voiceless. We're not voiceless. People just haven't been listening for hundreds of years. We've been screaming. Like, my elders have been screaming it long since before I was even born, and people weren't listening, but people are finally listening. So I think, like, just listen. And for me, like, that's the first thing that comes to mind is, like, I mean, I can go on from there, but a lot of times people just need to listen to indigenous folks and, like, hear out what we have to say.
I would say, just for me, because I work at, like, a predominantly white institution, and where I live is, like, mostly white, that a lot of people who do, like, have good, like, intentions, but it's not always, like, I guess needing to realize the difference between, like, the intention and the impact is, it's, like, always a really different. Like, so a lot of them just kind of want to, like, throw money at the at our problems, but like dictate how we like heal ourselves and how we like provide ourselves with the services we need. So I think for me, that's the main thing, is just people like checking their privilege a lot. And like, and just as an Indigenous woman, I think like, I know like a lot of our brothers, like their hearts are in the right place, but just like realizing like they need to check their patriarchy a lot of times and like not mansplain things and just really just provide the space and like let us do our own thing. And my brother next to me is really good at like doing all that. So I mean, other people, but no. So yeah, I would say those are the main struggles that I encounter, is just that. And then just, and always just because I feel like we're, even though we've been here, like, this is our land and we've been here, I still feel like, for me, I still feel behind and like still trying to catch up on all the stuff that was stolen from me, all the like things that were taken, and trying to just catch up on like my history, like even the right like language to be like an activist. You know, I don't know like all of those phrases because I was stuck in that like system of like success for so long. You know, like I know how I could quote Shakespeare and like do all this like stuff that like doesn't even like matter, you know, like wasted like so many years of my life like doing those things. Like that for me, like I feel like I'm just playing catch up, but it's mostly just about getting access, like access into spaces, and trying to like check my own privilege on that too, you know, like being more intentional, like if I do get to, like when we do a tour, like having an elder open and do a prayer, like finding a local person who's from there, like a local Indigenous person who can open our set or like perform and like really create the space and like help uplift each other and not just forget about that. Like I think that's the part that is for me. And then just thinking about academics, like people who do that work, to just also open up the space. Like for me, when working with kids and having done it for a long time, of people who just haven't really like worked, like done that on the groundwork, but just come in with all the fancy theories and words and stuff and try to just apply that to teaching to like the kids. And it's like kind of like know your role, like know, like how you said, know the struggle, but like make sure that you know where you're going into. And it's not just like, I can come in with all this stuff and I can fix it and know exactly this and that. And it's like, we just continue to perpetuate like that colonizing system, when it's just like, even our, as our own people, you know, sometimes coming into spaces and acting like we know how to fix everything without like getting to know like the lay of the land and the things that have been done before. So I think it's checking that balance.
I think most importantly, just the people that need to be on the panels usually aren't on panels. We have so much knowledge. We don't even know their names. They're not on television. They don't even have a mic, you know? So it really is, yeah. And if you're not talking to the children and women of that place, I don't feel really that you're, and you're not talking to queer and trans people of that land, you're really not talking to the community. And yeah, if you're not invited to someone's home and eat food with them, right, and someone feeds you and you partake of the food that they like made for you, and if you don't have that type of experience with an Indigenous person, then don't fucking talk about me or know of me if you're not invited to our house, right? And you just get your knowledge from panels, you know? It's, yeah. And then I will take a thing from Reverend Sekou, and he said, if you're not invited to a funeral of a family, of a community, or a wedding, then it's like people don't want to be with you to mourn what's important to me. Yeah, what's important, you know? And then if you didn't get invited to a wedding, you know, to that land or those people, then, dude, they don't want to spend their joy with you. They don't want to dance with you. So, yeah, so if you haven't had a meal, if you haven't gotten invited to someone's house, if you haven't been to a funeral or a wedding or both of that community, don't try to be like you're an expert of that community when these are basic human things that a human wants to share with you. And many of that is not articulated or can be understood. You know, it needs to be experienced.
So also, I just want to add to that too. I've been saying, I did a talk in Philly, and somebody asked me, you know, what can we do? Because we have some ignorant motherfuckers in our movement. We have ignorant motherfuckers in our culture. And we need to hold our own people accountable as well for being dumb as fuck in 2018 when everything is available to you on the internet. I'm sorry I curse so much, but you're new that, right? Okay, I'm just making sure. I've always been like this. But, you know, it's really, really important. It's like, I just want to give you an example. So Mark Lamont Hill talks about this. We were at the American Muslims for Palestine event in Jersey a few months ago. And this is real as fuck, and it's sad. And he talks about it because I flipped out. But because you have to, nothing matters if you don't address it in the moment. It doesn't matter. You know what I'm saying? Like it's gone. Like you have to address shit like when it's happening. And he did a really great talk. He was a keynote speaker, and then he comes out to my table and he's like, "Yo, this woman." This Palestinian lady came up to me, this old lady or whatever, and she was like, "Oh, you go to Palestine and bless you, you go to Palestine and you see the black Palestinians." And she's like, he's like, "Yeah." And he's like, "Which ones do you see?" And he was like, "Well, you know, I go to the Afro-Palestinian Society in Jerusalem." And she's like, "Oh yeah, they're good black people, right? Not like here." Damn. Right, like not like him or his family or his kids, you know what I'm saying? And the organizer that was standing right, I was like, "Who the fuck said that?" I was like, "Can you show me her?" The organizer was like, "I was going to hang myself from the chandelier." I said, "You should have, motherfucker, because you didn't say nothing." And it, you know what I'm saying? Like, where is she? And I wanted to go in, and they were like, "No, I'm wilding out." That's why I don't get asked to talk too much, because I do wild out. But it's the truth. I mean, but it's like you have to address that shit. You have to hold your people accountable. And we do have a lot of ignorance. You know, in our own communities that we have to address. So on top of the, you know, the freeloading ass wannabe something that they're not. It's like, and then on top of that, like our oppressors, our colonizers, they want everything. They want our food, our clothes, our music, everything, but they don't want us. Like, how does that work? You know what I'm saying? All these tanning salons. We should have opened them businesses. So another really important thing that I want to talk about is, you know, does anybody know the Freedom Theater? Can you put your hand up if you've heard of the Freedom Theater in Janine? So the Freedom Theater was founded, it used to be called the Stone Theater. It was founded by a lady called Arna Merchamis, who married, she was a Hungarian Jew who was born in Palestine in 1935. As she got into her teens, she joined the Jewish militias that were taking over the land. And then later on met my uncle, who's the founder of the Communist Party in Haifa in 48. And they're both passed away now. Anyway, she opened a theater called the Stone Theater in Jenin refugee camp. And then Israel bombed it in 2002, like they do, when they flattened Jenin in the Battle of Jenin. And her son, Giuliano, reopened it as the Freedom Theater in 2006. And he made a documentary called Arna's Children. It's free on Google Videos, YouTube. You could check it out. It's A-R-N-A-S, Arna's Children. It's one of the deepest documentaries you will watch. Like, I've just seen grown men cry when they watch this shit. Because what he did with this documentary is you follow these kids from a young age, from when his mom was training them, you know, giving them a way to express themselves. And he basically humanized these children that this country's worked so hard to deem as terrorists. But it shows you why they do what they do. So some of these kids grow up and some of them became suicide bombers and things like that. But you see why that happens. So that's a dope document. Anyway, Giuliano, my cousin, got assassinated 2011. And I say that because, you know, when things like that happen in a movement, especially when you go hard, and as artists, I'm sure you'll deal with shit differently. But there's always, like, I don't know, like, sometimes there's this big block that just hits you. It's like when someone dies, you know, like, you try and block it out, and then it's like a train. You could be in the supermarket, that shit goes boom, and it just, you know what I mean? And it happens, I don't know, for me, I've been doing this a long time, and it happens, it's happening more frequently, but it happens where, you know, like, you just feel like a block, like, you just can't do nothing, like, you just feel helpless. You know, After 2014, I met people, you know, I met one brother, I have to shout him out, Hassan al-Hallat. I'm sure you heard about his story. He was 32, he lost his 29-year-old wife who was 8 months pregnant with their third kid. He lost his 4-year-old, his 6-year-old, his mum, his sister's 2-year-old, and his brother-in-law. And he was still smiling when I spoke to him. And that, you know what I mean, like that kind of strength. Like, it's hard, you know what I'm saying? So I just want to know, like, as organizers, as artists, as people that go hard, how do you deal with times like that? You know what I'm saying? How do you push yourself to keep going?
That's a really great question. I've had many of those moments in my life, and a lot of it stems, you know, I have a really serious issue with, like, depression and anxiety and PTSD and, you know, thoughts of suicide, and a lot of Native people I know struggle with that, even if we don't talk about it, and it's because, you know, we survived 500 years of a genocide and occupation we were never able to talk about or learn about or heal from. So that's why, you know, like, Native children are 10 times more likely to commit suicide than the national average. So it's been waves of that throughout my life. And, you know, the funny thing is like, I felt like I couldn't even stop even when I wanted to. You know, it's like there's just something deeply ancestral spiritually, I think, keeping us going as colonized people, all Black and brown people. Like, because if there wasn't, we wouldn't be here with everything that they tried to do to all of our people throughout history. And I think for me, that's a testament to the strength of our spirits, you know, like, they can do whatever they want to our lands, to our bodies, to our language, but they can't touch our spirits, even when they tried. And, you know, but they try to disconnect us from spirit. And I mean, we live in a city we're in a city right now, deeply disconnected from spirit. Like, I'd have to go for miles just to put my feet on the earth, for real, you know? Like, there's so many things in Western society that disconnect us from our spirit. And I think one of the things that has helped me before I realized, you know, that I do have a purpose, and my life does have a purpose, and I am worthy, is remembering who I am and where I come from and just everything. Because, you know, all of us here in this room, I bet we've just, each of our lives could probably be a story just to even end up here in this room, everything we've had to go through. So I think practicing remembrance really helps keep me rooted and grounded when those times are tough, just reminding of myself, of my spiritual strength and all the ones that came before me, you know, all the things that my great-grandparents and their great-grandparents had to go through, just so I could even be sitting here on this panel in the People's Forum in New York City. You know, I stand on so many shoulders of all of my ancestors that survived so much, you know, just horrible things, but that's a testament to our spirit, you know. So I think just, and times do get hard. So also, like, my art has been a good, you know, when I'm just defeated and I'm really frustrated, I'm really angry, I'll just sometimes all I can do is put it in my music and write a song about it. And, you know, I just picked up playing bass. Play a few instruments, but picking up a new instrument helped me through a really dark time lately, and then I ended up writing songs on that instrument about what I was going through in a way that I didn't know I was going to. So I think just, like, remembering the strength of the long line of, you know, just strong spirits that we all come from, all as Black and brown colonized people, and everything we had to go through, and the fact that they can touch our lands, they can touch our bodies, they can do everything they did to us, but they can't touch our spirits. And at the end of the day, we are our spirits. We are our spirits. And so listening to your spirit, listening to your ancestors, because they're all around us here in this room too, and they prayed we would be here. They prayed we'd be alive. They prayed we would come together. They prayed we would find solidarity between our communities like this. And, you know, just being open and susceptible to those messages and to those prayers. I really believe that if you go searching for your ancestors, they will find you, you know, but you got to go looking, and they're waiting. They're waiting for us. They're waiting. And all the hardest times in my life, those dark times, those hardships, it was kind of when I wasn't listening to those ancestors, and I wasn't listening to my calling, and I wasn't listening to my spirit, you know, and my spirit was born to make music. So even if it's picking up a new instrument or whatever, you know, just finding your gift, listening to your spirit, and seeking your ancestors.
Beautiful. For me, I mean, I think it all comes down to, like, healing. Like, healing is so beautiful, but it's, like, super, super painful, you know? And for me, like, I didn't even realize it until, like, this year. And it actually, like, ties into Palestine. I'll tell this story about that. So, for instance, you know, I've been doing my job for over a decade, and in that time, like, I didn't even realize it until this year that I had just numbed myself for so long. You know, like, some of my kids, like, their parents will beat them with, like, pots and pans, and, like, will call CPS, and it finds out, like, CPS has been called before, and, like, still there's, like, nothing we can do, you know? Like, they still go back into these, like, abusive situations with their family, like, parents who, like, don't love them, parents who choose alcohol over them, drugs over them, and just seeing that, like, pain and, like, these kids, and they want to, like, commit suicide, like, they hurt themselves, like, it just... it just did, like, at first I used to just go home and cry and cry, but then I just, like, started becoming just so numb, like, so deadened inside, and part of that was just because of alcohol, you know? I binge drink really bad in high school and in college, but then when I was, like, adulting, you know, it was just a glass of wine here and there, and, like, that, I didn't realize, like, that was just me, like, quieting my spirit, like, not listening to it, you know? And it was only after, you know, Frank had gone to Palestine, and our sister Lila June was going to go to Palestine, so she wanted to talk to Frank to, like, just hear more about it and prep. And then while Frank was talking to her about it, he just started getting so angry, like, about the things that were happening. And then she was just like, brother, let me tell you, like, I could tell you're getting really angry right now. Let me pass on some teachings that she had about this thing called bad spirit, and that bad spirit's been around for decades, for centuries. Like, bad spirit is what made the colonizers, like, rape our women so that way we would feel that our wombs and that sacred part of ourselves was desecrated, but also to make the men feel like they had failed us, like they hadn't protected us, and that bad spirit, it manipulates people like that to, like, just pass on this bad, like, darkness. And then that turned into this conversation about the spirit of alcohol. And hearing Lila talk to Frank, like, about that, and then Frank sharing it with me, it just, like, snapped in my head. This was, like, in January, and I was just realized, like, I could literally trace back every trauma that had happened to me and every time I'd done myself back to, like, alcohol. And I just thought, wow. Like, and I decided, like, right then and there, like, I'm going to get sober. And then the next day, I could just hear that spirit of alcohol being, like, you like that brewery, just have a drink with your friend. I was just like, wow, like, how could I have, like, never heard this before? And once I, like, stopped drinking and started listening to my spirit, like, you know, I started playing guitar at the same time, like, songs just started coming to me, like, I could just hear, like, man, it was just like, I know, like, I know I'm born to sing, like, I know I am meant to sing, and just, like, finally having that block removed. And this summer was the hardest, you know, I cried, like, more this year so far than I have, like, in the past decade, just because all that blockage was finally gone. I could just start feeling those things. And what helps me heal is just, like, remembering my kids, you know, like, just thinking about all the kids I work with and, like, how they get through, and just, like, remembering to honor my spirit by singing and just drawing on community, you know, like, people who I see. Like, there's nothing more beautiful than seeing somebody do what they were born to do. Like, it's so beautiful. And, like, you know, there's a lot of people in the room tonight who even give me that strength, you know, like, my sister Noelle, my sister Rizelle, like, Autumn White Eyes back there, like, people just who do what they do with, like, with their heart work with just such passion and intentionality, and all the people here next to me, like, that's what helps me keep going in my art, is just learning to listen to my spirit and also just allowing myself to just soak in the beauty of, like, you know, everybody in this room. Like, we're all here for a reason, and just our spirits are happy together, and just really taking a moment to just, like, tune in on that and hone in on that. Like, I'm supposed to be here. We're all meant where we're meant to be right now. And just that always grounds me.
First and foremost, I would say that what really saves me or get right after the ancestors, because definitely the ancestor connection, yeah, most definitely that saves me. And second of all is knowing that what I'm going through is not a personal thing. It's a systematic thing. And it's a systematic, like, well-oiled, like, billions of dollars, right, go into the occupation of Palestine, of Turtle Island, billions of dollars to Oceania, like millions of troops, right, bodies are intentionally placed in these lands of occupation. So when I have my anxiety, when I'm, like, depressed, when I, and also, and it's great to just communicate that, to have family and community who listen to that, right? And hold that safe space for me. But also I think about, like, Moana, we're carrying all that genocide, all that rape, right? Queen Lukulani, the last monarch of Hawaii, she was on house arrest right before the Hawaii was annexed by, like, thousands of troops around her house, right? Like, there's so many stories like that we have in our DNA. So for me to not take it personal in the sense, like, oh man, Moana, you're so ugly, you're so fucked up, you're stupid, you know, just all those negative talk that we're raised to have, right? I know I was, because I was grew up in Utah, right? It's like, wow, you're just this brown, big person, like, right? And then when I came to a place where people are like committed to this, doing this intellectual work of knowledge of like, yo, Mo, that's like systematic, like racism, sexism, that's misogyny. Where people want put words to that. I love that. I love when people call out, that's what you call homophobia. That's what you call, you know, classism. Then I'm just like, what? Really? That's why you ate what you ate, Mona, not because your family was poor and your mom, they dressed so stupid, or, right? Just these negative things that we tell ourselves or each other of like why we're in where we are, you know? Like poverty's so criminalized in this whole world. Like, oh, you're in poverty. Yeah, that's how I was born, you know? And we're supposed to hate ourselves because of this, or you're supposed to hate yourself because you can't. It's like, no, that was intentional to hate yourself, and it serves a purpose. That purpose is so the 1% can be up here and be in control. And they like to tell us we have no power, right? Like, oh, you have no power. No, I may not have billions of dollars to use like mass media, but I do have the power that you will never get my mind, right? So, yeah, so shout out to everyone who perpetuates that knowledge of like, no, this is systematic oppression and teaches that along with our indigenous knowledge, right? That's like, no, girl, you feminist now, you know, or like, you know, like that has a name to it. So I love that I'm learning my indigenous names and indigenous words, and also learning liberation language.
Thank you, you're dope. And thank you so much to the People's Forum. I love you all, this is beautiful. Thank this you. Space is amazing. Can we make some noise for this space? Because I'm feeling this shit. I could just curse away. So I got a couple of thoughts while people were talking, because, you know, I told you I'm all over the place, right? So one was when you were talking about, you know, because I want to come back to what people can do, because it's great that you're here clapping and listening and shit, but what are you going to do from here, and how are you going to support our movements, right? Because it's always, that's one thing, literally I've been invited to meetings of like, oh, all the Palestinians are going to get together and we're going to actually do something, as if they haven't tried for the last 70 years, but motherfuckers just can't agree to disagree, and so it just goes on and on, but it's like, what are we actually doing? I'm sick of talking. And it's the truth, it's that saying, you know, like, you can, don't talk about it, be about it. You know what I'm saying? So I always ask, I always say to people, they're like, what you doing? I'm like, you could go on the streets in Palestine and ask about me. You can go in any refugee camp and ask about me. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm there. I don't just say, oh, I'm doing this for Palestine, I'm doing that for Palestine. If you're Palestinian and you are in the diaspora, or you have the privilege of not, you know, being stuck there, you have a duty to speak out. And if you don't, then shut the fuck up and be whatever passport you got and don't be Palestinian. You know what I'm saying? But from your idea, I want us to start a website, www.shutthefuckupandlisten.com. I think that would be dope, right? But what I want everybody just to give us a little, you know, just more towards your art, right? And the things that you do, how can people help? Like, what could people leave here and do? You know what I'm saying? For me, I'm just going to say, you know, we have this documentary coming out, Each One Teach One. That's why people say, why do you do these tours to Palestine? Because you can read a million books and you can watch a million documentaries, and that's other people's experiences telling you about what the fuck they saw, right? But when you go, because sometimes, like, I've taken people that don't really know nothing about Palestine. I took a Crip from LA who's a comedian. He didn't know nothing. I learned a lot from him because he was fucking up. Culturally, you know, there was things he was doing that you just don't do. Like, he ripped his shirt open in the street and started, like, doing all types of, like, stripper moves and shit. But the kids loved it. But it's just not something you do out there. You know, my boy, like, everywhere you go, everybody gives you coffee and tea and whatever. He tried to give my boy money in his hand, and they were, like, locked in hands. Do you remember that shit? For, like, 10 minutes. And I'm like, and my boy's like, come here. So I walk over. My boy says to me in Arabic, he was like, Khali'imi, like, tell him to move his hand and take his money. I'm like, Stevie, are you trying to give him money, bro? So, like, things like that, you know. But, you know, I've taken people that knew nothing,
And it's changed their life forever. And if I had, and prior to me taking him, having a conversation about Palestine was really difficult. You know what I'm saying? He would get stuck. Like, you know, there'd be a Zionist and they'd throw some shit out. You know, oh, it's not a wall. It is a security fence. Fuck out of here. Ain't no fucking security fence. That's bullshit. I'll tell you that because we've taken a million motherfuckers across that security fence. God, my mind, sorry. He's now able to actually talk from his experience. So he's like, no, that's a fucking wall, bro. Like, that's an open air prison. Like, that's what the fuck it is. It's an open air prison. Same company, G4S, is building that security system that's building the fucking wall with the stolen land on Mexico, Mexican land. So, you know, it's crazy. We learn, you know what I'm saying? Like they've learned a lot. And so I want people to get their own experience and be able to talk from that. I don't want you to talk from somebody else's experience. So for me, it's important that people, if you have the chance to, you can do a fucking Kickstarter and raise the money. We had somebody, shout out to Dariella from the PSL, she raised the money in 2 weeks and came. And you know, you can do it. You raise the money for a year and then come on our tour next year. But go visit Palestine. We've got all the connections, existenceisresistance.org. That's what, you know, what I ask people to do.
Cool. So I'll try to hit some bullet points. I know most of us come from, like, you know, colonized people, but I'll say off the top, if anyone here own land, give it back to the indigenous tribe it was stolen from. That's like, I always say, give the land back, like, give the land back if you can. But as far as, like, as you know, our art goes, Tanaya and I got a merch table over there if you like her poetry, her singing, get her book, get my CD. I mean, we're independent indigenous artists coming from poor reservations, raised by single moms. You know, it's like, we never get what we're worth in this colonial society. We never do. Like, that's the bottom line. I'm sure we all can relate to that, you know? So just, like, supporting each other in what ways we can through our art, like, even if it's being able to buy a CD or, you know, get a book or whatever. But tomorrow, I'm releasing a new song. I'm going to perform it tonight, but it's a song in my language called Wokiksuye, and Wokiksuye is our word for remembrance, so it kind of goes back to when I was talking about remembrance keeping me grounded and rooted. But it's a music video, and this music video was directed by, filmed by, shot by, starred, created costumes by kids on the Pine Ridge Res. There's this youth film camp called Outlast Film Camp. These black and brown film students from Cali come out and do this film camp. And Tanaya and I went out a couple summers ago and spoke to the kids and developed a working relationship. But this summer, her and I went out there and filmed music videos with the kids. They, like, directed it all. They did it all from the ground up, and they had really great gear. And it's one of my favorite projects. It's coming out tomorrow. I think pretty 90% sure we got Teen Vogue on the drop. It's going to be in Teen Vogue. But check that video out. You know, I always tell people to just follow indigenous artists, filmmakers, musicians, writers. Like, we're speaking about our communities and our realities, and that history comes out in our art, because if we're going to talk about our lives, that history affected our lives. I mean, all of us here, we're not like historians. We just came up here and told our personal stories, but you got a piece of history in all of it. And so I think indigenous artists are a great way to see yourself in our stories without necessarily having to just sit there and have, you know, facts thrown at you. And I think art is a great way to create pathways of empathy, because you can bring emotion with art. And emotion is where you can make a connection, like, oh, I understand. I feel what that feels like. And, you know, I may not ever know what it's like to be on a res, but through this song, through this film, through this book, I feel that. And I can understand, you know, what this community is going through. And I think those pathways of empathy between all of our colonized black and brown communities are where a lot of the work is for me, because divide and conquer was a real tactic that colonizers used. Even on our reservation, they put us on reservations. We still had a sense of community. Then they divided us into communities, spaced out, to divide us even further. So, like, I could talk about divide and conquer on my res, and it goes all the way up to everyone in this country. You know, they kept us separate from knowing about each other for a reason, because once we banded up, you know, we got the numbers. They got all the money and the power, but we got numbers, and there's a reason why they keep us ignorant about each other. And so, you know, just follow indigenous artists, support us, donate to our scholarship. Tanaya and I, Dream Warriors, we started a scholarship just out of our pocket for Native kids that wanted to be artists. Literally, like, we were reading the applications, cutting the check from, like, our bank accounts, but it just got picked up by Indian Education, Inc., and it's an online application form now. You can donate. You get tax write-off, all that colonial BS, but, you know, like, support indigenous people rooted in community. I think that's the thing. Sometimes indigenous voices that aren't rooted in community will get uplifted in settler society, because that's what the settlers want. You know, so like look for the artists that are rooted in community and deeply affected by the issues they're talking about, because those are the ones that are really bringing the truth, deeply rooted in and deeply affected by the issues they're speaking about. So, you know, that's my advice.
Yeah, I'll just echo what Frank said and said, donate to our scholarship. I have cards over there if you're interested, because, you know, we're still learning. We only awarded our fourth scholarship this year so far, but, you know, we want it to be that mentorship system where we can, like, not just give them money, but help give them opportunities. Our artist who just won this year, she actually drew my headshot on the back cover of my book, so I always just believe in, like, sharing my platform whenever I get it, however big or small. Like, my cover is done by a First Nations artist. She's Haudenosaunee. Her name's Aura Last on Instagram and Twitter and stuff like that. She did his album cover as well. So if you're over there, like, we just try to support in that way. And I would say, like, for those of you, just to find out wherever you're living or wherever you're at, like, know whose land you're on, like, connect with the indigenous people there, see how you can help give back, whether it's donating to, like, an intertribal house or things or their events, or just helping, like, volunteer, because we are really small people. Like, sometimes there's little pockets, but we can always use, like, more help and more, like, allies who, like, listen and don't try to overtake the space, but just come and, like, offer their body to come help and just support different things. And then the last thing I would say, so I'm definitely, I feel like I'm getting started late in the game, but, like, follow me on social media if you can. I'm going to have my first EP coming out soon. It's called For Women and Girls on Fire, and I'm really excited about it. Thank you. It's like, I have a really amazing cousin who, he's a dispatcher on our res, and, like, his music comes second, but it's his passion. He plays every day, but, like, he just really doesn't believe in himself, but he's just an amazing guitarist. Like, he could hear anything and play it. Like, he's never taken a class and no training, but he's just dope, and so he's featured on a couple of my tracks, and so just to, again, you know, just continue uplifting people and showing them that everybody has a gift and everyone has a purpose, but yeah.
I agree with what everything has been said, and whenever you can take a risk, do, and that could happen anytime, meaning if you see something, you know, that, you know, an injustice, whether, I wasn't gonna end that, you know, really stand up for someone, like, make it a point in your day, every day, to stand up for someone else. Just in your daily life, and also just be tender with somebody, even yourself, because, yeah, it's just a lot of shit that we live, and especially in New York City, just, like, have eye contact with one person and smile. That kind of could make a difference.
It really can. A smile could go a really long way, because someone could have the most shittiest day of their life, and your smile, it could be goofy as fuck. Just you know what I'm saying? But that shit could make all the difference, you know? Seriously, you don't know, because people be going through shit. Even the people that you think are the strongest people be going through shit. So check on your people, you know what I'm saying? And I like to go by their dumbass ad, which was really, if you see an Arab, say something, the see something, say something, but go by that. See something, say something. You see some bullshit, say some shit. You know what I'm saying? Say how you feel. Say how you feel. We're going to open it up for a Q&A. Gave me the rock on sign. Is that the? There you go. yeah, you want to go for it.
You're both Native Americans. Yeah. What do I look like to you? Be honest. When you see me, what do you think?
To me, you could be Native or Black and Native.
There you go. Part Cherokee. Later on, I heard that somewhere along the line, but I think it's on my grandmother's lineage. Black Indian. Well, I will say it like this here. I know about the colonization. I know about the Catholic school. I learned about that later on in life. But the situations that you're going through on the reservations is happening to Black America now. The single motherhood, the education, the miseducation, as Carter G. Woodson talked about back in the days of the Negro. So this is nothing new, even what Trump knows did in those camps. They did that to us back 500 years ago. Now finally the world is seeing what America is like. And even with the Palestinians, I stand with your struggle. Seriously, I wish I could have done more for it. I mean, even in the days with South Africa and whatever, I'm from the days where we was standing up for South Africa, and finally they got their freedom. But is it freedom or is it an illusion? Okay. But the thing, what I will say this to you, as Frederick Douglass once said, without no struggle, there's no progress. And I will say this in terms of Native Americans. I know about the diabetes that's happening on the reservations, the alcohol. They introduced alcohol to us during the time of slavery. Diabetes is hitting our community like crazy. So we share the same struggles together. But I will say it like this here, with faith and hope and prayer, things do change. It's never the same, but it changes.
Thank you.
And good luck with that with Palestine, and I stand in your struggles, and I stand in this other sister's struggles as well, too. Another thing I want to say real quick, I never thought that I would actually see the days of seeing people rap internationally. I'm from that generation. They used to say in the 80s, rap will get played out. But now it's an international movement.
Yakoke chia loka chi ene. Hi, my name is Regan. I'm Choctaw. First of all, I just wanted to thank you for all of your words. Super inspirational. I'm ready to like scalp some people. I'm ready to kick some ass. But more importantly, beyond my own violence, what I wanted to ask was about performative allyship. You know, it's like really hot and like sexy to be like queer and like Native and like all those things. And so I just wanted to know how all of y'all kind of cut through the bullshit and are able to actually provide resistance in a world where resistance is capitalistic now. Like you can buy that shit on a t-shirt. So that's all I want to know.
So
it's a simple question.
So you could buy our t-shirts, they're right there. But check it, right? Our t-shirts, I'll tell you how gangster we are. All of our tours that we've done have been the brokest, realest fucking tours on earth. That's why people like our tours, right? We silkscreen all of our t-shirts, and we've done so for the last 10 years. Even through the process, the artist that designed our shirts lost his studio because, you know, gentrification and whatever. And so we have the machines in my friend's backyard in Brooklyn, and that's how we keep making these t-shirts. We haven't taken a single penny from any organization affiliated with anything we don't fuck with. I have a 9-to-5, people. People that know me be like, you have a good job. I'm like, yeah, someone hired me. And I actually do, I do, she curses too, which is dope, my boss, right? But I do actually work. I work in mental health. And on the weekends, I spend my time. I was just in Minnesota last week, and people are like, you travel so much. I'm like, yeah, I'm raising money so that we could do the fucking tours in Palestine and finish this film and blah, blah, blah. But the money for the t-shirts, all of it goes back into our work in the West Bank, and that's how we've sustained our organization. And basically, that's how we cut through the bullshit. Like, if we don't fuck with you, we don't want your money. You know what I'm saying? I manage my sister, and her being a Palestinian artist, she gets hit up for big shows. We've turned down thousands of dollars because we need to know who's putting the money up for this shit. And if it doesn't run with us, we don't want your fucking money. We don't need you, right? We're not going to be the puppets, you know what I mean? And my last thing I would say on that is you just got to speak your mind, you know? You can't be afraid to speak your opinion ever. You know what I'm saying? It's like that you snooze, you lose. You really do, you know what I mean? So you just got to say how the fuck you feel and follow your gut. That's, shout out to Sekou Odinga, a brother that gave 34 years of his life. He's like a father to me. And he told me, always go with your gut. And he keeps telling me that, go with your gut. And I'm trying still. I'd be fucking up, but I'd be trying.
So to your question, how do you cut through the bullshit? And again, I gotta go back and thank my community, because my whole family is still back home on the res, everyone I love. If I was out here faking the funk, I couldn't go home. I couldn't go home. I mean, they'd be like, what the hell? You're out there, like, putting on a show for the white people? Like, don't come around, you know? So, like, just being rooted in my community, and as I progressed, like, I wasn't conscious of it, but I just remained authentic because I love my home and I love my people, and I didn't want, you know, so I never crossed that line of, like, and there definitely were those opportunities where, like, settlers will present you opportunities where they want you to put on, or, you know, they're going to give opportunities to the voices that aren't rooted, but like I said, you know, just remaining deeply rooted in and affected in the issues I'm talking about. I'm not going to talk about something I don't know, you know, everything in my music and I stay on stage is stuff that I've cried and bled about, you know, so I remain rooted in that. And just like she said, just being my true self everywhere I go. And Tanaya knows probably more than many stories of this because she's my manager and we travel and perform together. But whether it's like a white space, a native space, we've done stuff in Europe. Like I go in and I'm like, I'm going to do what I do no matter what. And if I piss people off and don't get invited back, then that space ain't for me. But if I get invited back, then, you know, those are my people and that's my space. So just remaining authentic to who you are. And I think, again, goes back to just being rooted in the community that I'm talking about. And in Indian country, there's a lot of people that are getting paid to talk about communities that they're afraid to set foot in, you know, and that's the truth. And so like, you know, just remaining true to yourself and knowing that success from an indigenous standpoint, and Tanaya and, you know, the rest of the artists we roll with talk about this a lot. It isn't about money or fame or, you know, this colonial system is so backwards. Like, it ain't even civilized. They poison their own water. Like, this isn't civilization. Like, so just looking at success from trying to redefine it from a different perspective. And for us, success, like, you know, yeah, I've been on TV and stuff, but, like, that was never my goal. My goal is, like, the work in our community. So to me, that's successful. Like, I'm not rich. I make a living doing what I love, and I'm very privileged and blessed to do that. But I've passed on many of opportunities where I could have, like, been making more money or doing something. I've passed on European tours because they were trying to stereotype us in the flyers. So just, like, remaining rooted and true to yourself and knowing that, you know, it's okay to say no sometimes, and when those opportunities come around, or if you're in a space and you be yourself and, you know, you get this sort of energy from these colonial people, like, you know, that's okay because those spaces aren't meant for us, you know?
Oh, yeah. So I guess sifting through the bullshit, sifting through my own bullshit. Same thing, like just being grounded in, like, home, like making sure that I make trips home, like I go home as often as I can, making sure I, like, go and, like, step on the earth, like be in the mountains and trees, because it makes me remember how, like, small I am, like next to the big mountains, that I'm just, like, a visitor here on this earth. And just also grounding myself in ceremony. You know, I like going home because to my family I'm just like Cookie. I'm not like Tanaya, you know. I'm just like, I get to be me, you know, and just like making sure I always do the work, you know. Like I'm always really tired because, like, I do this and my full-time job and I teach online too, but, like, always making sure every time I go home, I'll sit with different elders, like, to try to learn the language, to just hear things from them. And I'll help my mom, you know, like, she takes care of 2 sweat lodges at her house, and, you know, and it's, like, humbling, like, carrying these heavy rocks and, like, cleaning the ash and, like, doing it in the snow and, like, cleaning out, like, the mud when it, like, rains a lot. Like, that stuff is always very, like, humbling to me, but I'm always really grateful for it because I get to spend time with my mother, who always, always, like, puts me in check, you know. People in my community even follow me on Twitter and tell my mom when I use a swear word because she doesn't let me swear. So, like, she'll be calling me right away and be like, someone said, you said, fuck, I didn't raise you like that. So nobody posts this that I said that because she'll see it. So, like, stuff like that. And just, like, it's hard because, like, I feel like I'm a really trusting and naive person, too, to a fault. But, like, now that I'm getting older, it's, like, people will show you who you are eventually. Like, people will show their true colors. And, like, it is, like, very much trusting, like, your gut, you know. And, like, just, like, having your inner circle that just knows that, like, true part of you. Like, sometimes we jokingly have, like, a no new friends rule. Like, just because it's, like, hard to, like, meet people, you know. It's, like, you got to keep your circle tight. Like, people who, like, you know, got you and, like, just support you, like, people who, like, if I didn't do this, like, if I stopped doing this tomorrow, like, people who would still love me just for me, like, those are the people I consider genuine. And just, like, things I pick up from Frank, like he's a part of another artist collective like Iman, and like just things he learns on their retreat, like the power of storytelling, you know, like asking people like, well, who inspires you? Like, who, like even just stuff like this, but in general conversation, I think just the power of story like reveals so much about a person and their intentions. And if they can't like answer like specifically about those genuine things, then you know, like there's someone you don't want to fuck with.
Definitely. I mean, yes. What everyone said, cut through the bullshit, be your true self, and stand up for yourself and stand up for others, pretty much, yeah. You know, so I'm so happy that you're like, yep, do it right after this, going out, you know, like some fuck some shit up, you know, however you want to do that.
Okay, who has a cell phone? Put your cell phone up for a second. Who has a cell phone? We need to do something really important. Everybody pulls out their fucking cell phone for everything else. Pull out your goddamn cell phone. It's gonna take you 2 seconds. All right, you got a calendar. Who's got a calendar? Put this date in your fucking cell phone. The 23rd, we're doing an event here. It'll be myself and Mark Lamont Hill. We'll be talking about the black communities in Palestine, getting you ready for the documentary. That's the 23rd of October. What time is it? See, I'm so prepared. We're gonna find out, but put People's Forum. It's gonna be in the evening. We know that much. I think it's at eight. I think it's at 7:30, 8 o'clock. So the 23rd. Is there anything else that you want to put some dates out there? Because you know we got their phones out right now.
Eight o'clock.
8 o'clock.
You can also follow People's Forum on social media.
You should follow it and hashtag it right now and tag it with our beautiful faces. We'll pose real quick if you want to take some pictures. All right. we have some really beautiful performances coming up. Should we get rid of this table? Or are they just going to just use an open space? How do we want to do that? We'll take it out. So we'll give them a couple of seconds. Okay. So let's just take a couple minutes. You can come buy some T-shirts and some books. We'll be over at the tables. And we actually have a little surprise for you, too. Somebody's going to open this up for us today that came a long way. So... definitely come back in a few minutes.
To our panelists, oh damn, that sound. We want to also give it up for our DJ, DJ Agua Panela. So she's going to be playing some tunes while we get set up for the concert. Stick around. It's going to be a good lineup.